For the next part, I'll hand over to Luca on operationalizing, having constructed the concept for understanding. You need to move on to internalization.
I created this simulation. So for the worksheet, for this part about the operationalizing the concept, can you refer to the handout which I gave you, the 12-page document? The applet is already freely downloadable, so you can just use it in your classroom. Okay, so for this part, operationalizing, I think it's a good practice in general to give the students an overview, a description. So this is, in this case, an EC generator. So if I refer to page 1, which I'll skip because we're all physics teachers, page 2 is just the way the definition and how the various words are defined. I think what is really interesting is, okay, page 3 is also the definition. If you dwell into the mathematics, you can actually go inside the source code for the simulation and see that this is the way it is built. Okay, can I, on page 6, okay, the rest you can read on your own in the interest of time. Okay, page 6 is the exercise in which we can use this blended learning, how to operationalize and get students to understand this concept. So what I design is this. Okay, at first, as an exercise, first by engaging them, you can ask them a question. So the question I design here, feel free to come up with your own. So given the context of global energy crisis, fossil fuel as primary source of energy and its effects on global warming, are you aware of any alternative energy source? So this question, I hope that can get the students to think about global issues, something that is very real, and then later on tie back to the AC generator. So you may want to try something like that for your own students. Okay, then I give the possible responses as well as the answer. I hope the answers is okay, right? So yes, you know, wind energy and all that, it can come from AC generator. But like what Patron has shown, the various videos to engage the students, a real demo, getting the students to try on their own, like now, here, now, then, and later do come by and take a look at them, is perhaps the best way to get the students to learn, and it's a lot more engaging. Okay, so I put it down there, and then the picture is actually taken by our Dr. Tan. Okay, then I'll get the student to explore the simulation. You know, get them. So what I do is this, I pretend I'm the students. For those of you who have computers, if any of you have computers and would like to try it, because I have a thumb drive, you can just copy the file and then you try. Okay, good. So explore the simulation, you can read point 1 and all that. Okay, so if I do very quickly, let me just explain this to you. This is an electrical generator that turns motion. So it is, there's a hand here, there's a crank here. Okay, so the students can rotate this, and then this is under the influence of the magnetic field, and because of the slip ring, then you can find that AC generator is electromotive force can be detected over the other end of the terminals here, which I connect to a galvanometer. Okay, then I put a resistor here. These are all cosmetics. Okay, but the mathematics is correct. Internally, it behaves mathematically as if there's a resistor there. The students, normally what we do is you get the student to explore, you can ask them to design, like, you know, ask them to click play, you know, because this is a completely safe environment, nothing can go wrong. You know, you don't have to worry about electrocution, I think. So you can get the student to explore this, then you can get them to look at the reading and make sense of all this variable. So because we are express learners, so I don't want to go step by step, but you can see that there are certain steps, certain scaffolds, procedure that you want to guide the students along. Okay, so I already put down, okay. So first, you may want to get them to explore about the play. Okay, this is the play button. This is the forward button. Just look at the simulation time and time, because this is something you cannot do in real life, right? You can't freeze time, but in computer simulation, you can. This is to reset the whole thing, so that it goes back to default value. So the student can do physics inquiry in a completely safe environment. They can press 1 here, press play, and see what happens. Okay, you can even ask them to check at the various check boxes. So this is to check the PZ. P stands for magnetic field. Z means Z direction. This is a new Tesla. So what will happen is if the student were to do this. Yeah, okay, it's correct. Because if you rotate the B field, it's supposed to still rotate because there's a hand there grabbing. Okay, so you can see that the EMF generator is different now because of the change in direction. Okay, then you can get the students to play the length, you know. If you reduce the length, what will happen? Okay. If you reduce the length, there will be a lesser change in flux and then the corresponding EMF induced will be lesser. So these are all mathematically driven models done by physics professors. I'm just a physics teacher who look at the code and then just change them, customize it so that people like us can use our own pedagogies. We want students to learn by inquiry. Besides learning from wonderful setup, real setup like this, sometimes you face with a real constraint. In school, you don't have money. How they support you, but the money, how are you going to go about to implement inquiry, business by inquiry? So this is perhaps one possible way because it's completely free and you can download it offline and use it. So this is the number of turns and all that. So you can get the student to explore this. Maybe I just explain to you. This is the angle. Okay, you leave your mouse there long enough. You can right click it, change the GUI option, increase the font size. So all this physics community has already talked about a lot of things in terms of scaling. Okay? So this is the angular displacement, this is the angular or angular velocity. This is the time, this one is because it has run to the end, so that's why it doesn't even progress, but it is a moving number. This is the flux. If you check the flux, can you see increasing and decreasing the flux? Can you see the black like area? Okay, so this is my interpretation of what is the flux. So it's the area that's being enclosed by the coil. So I'm sure my physics there should be some conceptual error. Please do let me know that I can change it. Okay, this is the induced EMF, this is the induced current, and this is the velocity at the tip of the coil. So you press shift, mouse click, and then drag out. Then you can check this. So this is the velocity of the end of the electrons. I'm trying to show whether it's a current or electron. And this is the velocity vector as the coil rotates in a circular motion. Okay, so maybe let's come back to the worksheet from 2 onwards to about 10, the point number 10, in page 7. This is my attempt to design something called get them to explore the simulation. Questions, and get them to think about what is the simulation about. So for example, you look at point number 14. There is an external magnet with the poles and set up in the Z direction. What are the magnetic poles when PZ is positive? So then I guide them, okay, what's the top, what's the bottom? So now they are supposed to make sense. What does this solve? Because if they don't understand the symbols, they can never understand the meaning that is being represented here. So this is the north pole, the magnet is the south pole. How do I know? You can switch it around, and by looking at the vector representation of BZ, whether it's negative means down, because Z is positive upwards. So you can see that this is the north pole. Okay, maybe I just go through go to the most critical, okay, which is number 18. Can you turn to page 9, number 18? Okay, number 18 is like this. Now that the student have gotten, you know, they're engaged, what they say, wow, global warming, wow, very interesting, maybe I must learn this. Then we talk about explore, you know, and they think about, oh, then they make sense of all these applet, all the various symbols. Then now this is the part where we get them to think. So I'm trying to, through this table, I'm trying to get them to do inquiry learning. So in this table, I'll tell them, okay, step through the simulation by delta t, take note of the new value of delta and the new reading, the flux reading. By calculating the flux over dt at the instant of time, think of a way to collect data to fill the rest. So you can see, I did not tell the student what to do. The student had to do some thinking, perhaps in groups they can discuss, and then they can figure out how to fill the blanks. So basically, the idea is this. It isn't that difficult. That's why I thought it was doable as a activity. Let me just show you the graph. Let me do it again. So basically, you can see that as I step through the time, I'm telling the student guided inquiry. I'm telling them step through the time delta t, and then record the angle. Okay, record the angle. The angle is given. Okay, then write down the time. So the time the student can read from here. Okay, how much the time? 0.2. You know. Oh, this one I have to change. This one I have to redesign it because I think this is supposed to be 0.25, 0.20, that kind of thing. Okay, so the student will record all this, then they can look at the flux, record it. Okay, then there's something called d phi over dt. Okay, d phi over dt. This is the full cycle. Okay, this is the angle represented. This is the time represented. So these are two different scales. So this is the flux, the change in this is the flux, the magnitude of the flux. And then by differentiating this, they can get the induced EMF, but plus a negative sign. Okay? So rather than telling the student this, this table allows them to figure out the meaning embedded within the simulation. Okay, then what about the current? Okay, the current is the same shape as the induced EMF. But the magnitude will be different because it depends on the value of R, the resistor. Then the activity just keep on going. This is how one of the proposed steps that we can do, operationalizing the concept. And then it goes on to the end. If you were to look at the whole worksheet, we design it according to the syllabus. Then if you were to look at page 12, so what is the effects of induced EMF by increasing the I, double I and triple I? So then the student can do this is a bit guided, but I think it is good to have some questions which are simpler. So now the student can actually do this. I'm doing what is the effects of the induced EMF by increasing I, the number of turns on page 12. So you can get the student to increase. First you play without increasing N. Then you can look at the graph, which I have difficulty opening up, but it's here. Okay, the play button can be clicked on both sides, whether on the simulation or on this graph. So now, if I were to increase the N value, maybe I double it, change the number of turns to 2, and I play it. See, what's the maximum? Let's say about 13, right? Right, about 13. Okay. Now, if I increase the number of turns, let's say to double, I should expect to see 26, which is, can you see about that? Okay. So, you can get the student to do this and then figure out. Okay. And then, if you are daring enough, maybe this is in the near future, student can actually be the one changing the simulation. They can go inside, take a look at how it's made. But I think that is, it holds great promise for me as a teacher. Okay, I think that's the, any question about the simulation, operationalizing the concept?